When my Chinese friends talk about Suzhou, they always like to quote a classical old proverb. God has heaven, but we have Suzhou and Hangzhou. My friends from Suzhou would also mention the famous Jingji Lake Industrial Park, since it's a symbol of Suzhou's modernization. However, for me as a foreigner, I'm more interested in Suzhou's gardens and traditional culture. I learned from a book that about 1,000 years before, China was in a political state of corruption. Back then, many literary and high officials lived in seclusion from the political government. They came to Suzhou for their twilight years, hence many gardens were built. I'm curious as to why so many ancient scholars chose to go to Suzhou. And I'm open to get to know Suzhou better with this incredible opportunity. Experience the lifestyle of living in total seclusion away from society will be my mission in this getaway trip.
So here we are in Suzhou, and right now I'm in Shangtan Street. Well, this place has thousands and thousands of history. So if you come to Suzhou, this is a must place to come. So let's come and check it out and start our journey.
According to the author from the book, Zhu Yibai, who was the governor of Suzhou, built this road. He was a very famous great poet in Chinese history. This place, for instance, used to be the center of cargo ships distribution. Shantan Street was once the road of happiness. The elites who lived here chased fame and wealth on one hand, meanwhile treasuring the material world with the public citizens.
You know, there's lots of local people who are still living in this narrow, beautiful great lane. And a local friend told me that there's a special place who specializes in Chinese silk embroidery. I think this is the place, so I'm gonna check it out. Let's see. Ni hao.
Ni hao.
Ai, ni hao, ni hao.
Ai,
ni hao.
为什么选择这个地方呢？因为我们中国有句俗话叫大隐隐于市，对。然后我想做一个在巷子里的手工艺人，然后我选择这个地方叫桃花坞。他明代的时候有个大画家唐伯虎，他就住在桃花坞。然后桃花坞从明代到清代也是我们苏州手工艺的中心，它总共有30多种手工艺。 中国的剧种种类很多，它可能有上百种，但是它任何一个剧种，它都要用这个裙子。这个裙子就是唱旦角，生旦净末丑，就是女的。嗯，它这样子穿着，然后上面再穿其他衣服。 刺绣在苏州有很长的历史了，它在清代的时候，苏州是称为绣市，有些皇帝穿的龙袍什么，它都是在苏州做的。你看我们的老奶奶，他们大概从6岁就开始做了，对，做到现在可能有60年的时间了，做了一辈子。 这就在做缂丝，哦，它1厘米就有28根金线，1厘米28根哦，你看，对，
这个是很传统嘛，
对，这是传统的一个织布的方法，对，它称为缂丝，哇，对，以前在宫廷的时候，只有一些皇后娘娘才用的，嗯。
The designer gave me the opportunity to wear the Kyungchu opera costume to get a feel for it. I did some research on the scholars of Suzhou at that time who greatly loved music. They often invited governors, dancers, and singers to their houses to play instruments, dance, and enjoy the moment. The most innovations of Kyungchu opera were developed by several scholars in Suzhou. Locals here often tell me that the tea houses in Suzhou were the most popular place at that time. Pingtang includes storytelling and ballad singing and was one of the most popular forms of entertainment back in the old days. There's an old saying that says that if you have not seen any gardens in Suzhou, it's as if you have never come here in Suzhou at all. And this place has a very specific, a very special garden that has a very rich, long tradition. And guess what? This is also a hotel. So let's check inside.
The
traditional thought of ancient China advocates that people and nature coexist harmoniously. It's no wonder why scholars and hermits paid a big price to build their ideal homes at that time.
This area is our entire宅子的一个核心区域，它的名字叫做盘古楼。对，以前是它的一个文人雅士，到了这边之后，主人接待他们的一个中堂。 那我们抬头所看到的这些雕梁画柱是保留了原先的风格，我们在做修缮的时候是特意进行了一个打磨。盘古楼里面呢，更多的是赋予了它一个新的功能，客人可以在这边做一个文人雅集、沙龙、聚会、小型的这种 party 都可以。
I've also noticed some Chinese ancient landscape paintings. One of them is from a famous artist called Zheng Mingwen. On his paintings, we can usually see pretty Zhangnan sceneries covered with mountains and rivers, which also speaks about the different classes of people drinking tea during the Ming Dynasty.
Suzhou is the birthplace of many ancient scholars. These ancient scholars love paintings where there's water and mountain, along with a good cup of tea. So we're gonna go find out the places where they went and feel like a true, true ancient scholar. Let's begin.
The destination of our trip is Dongshan Mountain. This place offers a special kind of tea called Bilongchuan. It's originally grown in the East Mountain of Suzhou. Dongshan is located in the southwest of Suzhou City. It took us about 1 hour to drive there.
Many plantations here. It's unbelievable. And on my right is the Taihu Lake. I don't even have words to describe how breathtaking this vista looks like. It's surreal. It's just like a painting. I could just stare at this all day long. just come to the realization that we were already in the ancient scholar's painting. Great, so we found a local person who is currently preparing the tea for us. Wow, 你好, 师傅.
你好.
Wow. 师傅为什么要炒它?
一个公式就是杀青。 碧炉村呢, 人家别的地方也有, 但是我们这里的原产地就是在这里, 碧炉村。
So look at these. These are the bilunchun dry. These are ready after being fried for a while. This feels completely, completely dry. Although these dried tea leaves are ready to drink, I'd rather find a more ideal place to enjoy this cup of tea. This temple is located on a small mountain called Pangli. Right beside the mountain, there's Taihu Lake. No wonder the location of this temple is excellent. In several hundred years' time, the temple has been under a lot of different renovations. Master Lin Gen, who is the current monk of this temple, started repairing the two collapsing halls that was built during the Ming Dynasty. Today, these halls are nearly done now. So I've arrived at Yonghui Temple, and the reason why people like to come here is because of this stone here. This cliff stone actually has names inscribed of famous scholars and poets who came here and signed their names. So this has over 100 years old of legacy. Sipping the tea, overlooking the Taihu Lake, enjoying the precious quietness. Living in Shanghai can be stressful, so it's not a bad idea to free yourself a bit and go back in ancient times in order to get a glimpse of what the ancient scholars must have felt back in the days. Perhaps those refined scholars felt the same way as I'm feeling right now. Exploring a lot about Suzhou so far, but you're probably wondering, what about food? I mean, even the Asian scholars, they have to eat it, right? Well, I'm hungry and I spotted some fishing boats there. I'm wondering if the food's gonna be any good there. So this is where I'm going next. Let's go, follow me. Here is the fishing port of the Taihu Lake in Suzhou. It's the biggest inland fishing port in China and where most fishermen live. The boat motor launches. Here we come, Taihu Lake. This time, we couldn't catch any fish. The boatman told us that we weren't allowed to fish until after May 1st, which will continue throughout January of next year. That's fine, because the boatman already came prepared with fish from the market nearby, and he will cook something nice for us in a short while.
Boats like no other. Look at the size of the dining room table. It's crazy, it's big. 你好，怎么样? She's going to make us some fish today. Woo!
谢谢.
Wow. 这里是可以睡的吗?
可以.
Ah, look, this is where they sleep. 可以看吗?
看吧。
Okay, 谢谢。怎么? Oh, wow, this is like a room here. And there's like the basement even. This is much bigger than I thought. Ah, 这里是厨房. Okay, here's the kitchen. Wow. Look at this. This is surreal. It's like cooking with the ocean view. Wow. It's like a dreams come true here. Did you know that back in the days when the Asian scholars would come to Taihu Lake, they actually had two boats? So one was for just fun or leisure, and then the other boat was just for cooking purposes. And now I'm here in this boat and I can't wait to eat all this good food. I've tried to read Chinese poems before, but it's really hard for me as a foreigner to fully understand. However, I did learn that the lives of these scholars from the past were poetically freeing and poetically romantic. The purpose of this getaway trip was to seek Suzhou scholars' way of living. However, it has only scratched the surface of the spiritual life of the literary. In other words, put simply, you need to come to Suzhou by yourself to truly seek the essence of the true scholar culture in Suzhou.